Hello everyone, welcome back to Star Trek Online. This is Captain Kolos. He's loaded up this morning and I have a bit of a cold, so hopefully I won't be sneezing or coughing or sniffing or whatever too much, because that can be quite annoying. But anyway, we're going to proceed with the next mission in the Iconian War sequence. Very recently, Captain Kolos reached level 30. And he has a new ship as a result. He is now flying a Vorcha battlecruiser. This is an engineering-focused ship, which should suit our engineering-focused captain and his skills very well. However, it does not turn as quickly as I would like, and I still only really have my cannon weapons from previous ship. I need to find some time to go and collect some beam arrays, I think, for this ship. But we're going to press ahead. We're going to go on and see how we get on. So let's hail Captain Kagran to find out what he has for us today.
The research teams in the Kiana system require your assistance. They have been running thousands of temporal incursion simulations of how to use the Krynim weapon. But I need an officer with field experience to evaluate the project and its feasibility. You will participate in a focus test of the most promising options. A blade cuts both ways. We must be sure that what this weapon can do to the Iconians does not cause greater harm to us.
Wise words. So, let's see what we have. We have the usual skill points, expertise, featured episode weekly rewards, some training manuals, and dilithium ore. This is the first time I'm playing this mission through this week, so that's why the featured episode weekly reward is there. We have a choice of rewards. The mission has been available for quite some time now. All the rewards are opened up to us. We have the possibility of a science console, which gives a lot of boost to auxiliary systems. It boosts critical chance and critical severity, and it gives a boost to shield capacity as well. And this is the option I'm going to go for when I complete the mission and hand it in. I'm going to be picking this console as my reward. There is a warp core available, and it's a singularity core alternative for those who fly Romulan warbirds. Again, they give a lot of boost to auxiliary power systems. So these items will do very well for science-based captains, especially those who want the three-part option, who perhaps use Tetrion-based weapons, because there's a Tetrion beam array or a turret that completes the three-part set. Now, having two parts boosts your Tetrion weapon damage, so I'd imagine there'll be some science-based captains might pick up this console and the beam array or the turret to get the two-part boost. There are some better warp cores and singularity cores out there, but the third set part, the three-part set boost bonus even. I don't know what that was. What that's quite like. I haven't managed to collect it yet on any of my characters. I've got the two-part boost on one of my characters, but not the three-part set. I just haven't got around to it yet. The final option is a Chronoton torpedo launcher. This is a sort of bog standard piece that can be obtained in many different missions. Although, for some bizarre reason, in the new Iconian War story arc that's currently ongoing in Star Trek Online, all of these sort of bog standard rewards are now bind on pickup instead of bind on equip, which is somewhat annoying. Anyway, let's accept the mission and play it through. There's the Lisette and the Krynim timeship is obviously finished.
Welcome! We have been working with the Krynim to build both this facility and a weapon similar to the one developed by Anorax in the 22nd century. Captain Nog is running point for the Alliance, but teams from all across the Alpha and Beta quadrants are involved with the research. It's fascinating work, but there's a lot to do yet.
How can I help?
Captain Nog might be able to explain more. He's waiting for you.
I'll lead the way. Let's follow. He's got really skinny legs. She must be anorexic. I'll just call it Anorexic Adriana now. I don't know. Maybe that's offensive. I'll shut up. Let's just enjoy the game instead of taking the mick out of it. Let's talk with Captain Nog.
I wish I was seeing you under better circumstances. We've managed to make a prototype of the Krenim weapon in Anorax's records, but we have not attempted to use it yet. Time isn't something you mess around with, so we have been conducting simulations here of possible incursions, as well as developing new ways to protect and store data on various timelines.
Interesting. Can you explain the process to me? How is this different from going back in time, changing something, and creating an alternate timeline?
When we talk about time alteration, we're specifically referring to the Krenim weapon's ability to remove something from time. Anything, from a single molecule to an entire civilization. It's as if the target of the weapon never existed at all.
So it doesn't just move something, it deletes it.
Correct. The changes ripple out from the incursion point and result in a new reality where the target no longer exists. This does mean that the ship must be able to fire on a target. The details are a bit more complex, of course, but that's the main difference from conventional time travel.
And no one has a problem with this?
Temporal agents from all three factions are watching everything we do carefully. That's one of the reasons we're running holodeck simulations first. Between you and me, I'm glad they're here. The Krenim are a little too eager to use the weapon. Time manipulation is a very delicate operation under the best of circumstances. We can't just start shooting things out of existence and hoping it all works out for the best.
I agree with that. Do you have any ideas on when to make a temporal incursion?
We've tried a different number of scenarios, but only in the hollow.
Isn't that just delaying the inevitable for a few years?
Actually, it would be closer to a 700-year delay if our calculations are correct. The Iconians have had 200,000 years to build their fleets, but we're catching up to them. We've already seen what the 29th century technology can do. Imagine what we'll have in the 32nd century.
So, we're basically trying to be more on an equal footing.
Exactly. The other potential solution is to cut into the current power base. What if the Iconians never allied with the Alachi or the Solanae? We wouldn't be facing the trouble we do now.
So, what's your best scenarios?
The three most promising incursions each follow one of these tactics. My teams have been running simulations and refining their targets, but I'd like you to assist them using a special quantum recursive algorithm. Our simulators can run the outcome of a possible incursion on the holodeck. Interacting with that simulation will give us more data than just crunching the numbers. We need to really interact with it to see what reality would look like. And for that, I need someone like you with field experience.
Sounds like a fascinating experience. Speak with Alpha Team Leader Sofen. Here he is.
Hello. Please allow me to explain what we're doing here. We've determined that if we remove a specific series of stars from the Beta Quadrant in the distant past, a rogue planet will enter the Iconia system and cause massive geological damage at about the same time the planet was bombarded by the Iconians' enemies. The technological buildup of the orbital bombardment that destroyed the Iconian civilization will still happen, but the Iconians themselves will have to deal with a natural disaster, not a war.
This is better than a war?
Maybe the survivors of a natural disaster, if there are any, won't be so vengeful. And none of the stars we will remove have planets with the possibility of developing life. The overall effect on the galaxy is minimal. It's a painful path, but it could be the one that leads to peace.
I don't know if I like the idea of removing an entire star.
The number of stars we will have to remove is a concern, which is why we're trying this in a simulation first. But as Captain Nog said, these simulations aren't perfect, so we have devised a holodeck program that will expand and extrapolate on possible effects of the temporal incursion.
you're giving a lot of weight to the holodeck.
It's the best option we have available to us. The holodeck's algorithms have been updated to change and adapt to the data created by the simulated timeline alteration. This is not your average holo novel.
Okay, what do you need me to do?
Once we run the program, you'll be able to interact with our best approximation of the new timeline. Interaction with the holodeck components will allow the program to generate a more in-depth solution and give us a better idea of what to expect. We have set this simulation on a Federation starship patrolling the Sol system, and you are the captain. If all goes as planned, we expect that almost everything in the system should be close to current reality.
Okay, I'll run the program then. So the holodeck's up here according to the minimap. Okay, run program alpha. Whoa. This is not unlike the current timeline.
Captain, you're alive! We repelled the intruders on the bridge, but the ship has taken heavy damage, and a lot of the crew are injured.
What's the situation?
Sir, I'm not sure this is the time. So many people are hurt, and most of the systems are offline. The life support is on backups, and our resources are down to nothing, and...
I'll help the wounded, but you need to help me. What happened?
The Dominion stopped firing at us when we lost weapons. Now they're focusing on Earth's defense grid, but it's only a matter of time before they return to finish us off.
Okay, let's stabilize the crew and fight back. This isn't over.
Sir, I tried to fight them off, but the boarding parties, the Jem'Hadar. We have to stop the Dominion. They can't take Earth too.
Don't worry, we'll stop them.
I never expected they would get so far into our defenses. I'm sorry, Captain. I just need a moment. Then I'll be ready to fight.
Whenever you're ready.
We can't stop them. Maybe if we hadn't been at war with the Romulans. Maybe if the Klingons hadn't ripped themselves apart. I'll be fine, Captain. Just rattle.
Go to sick bay if you need to.
Incoming hail!
Incoming hail. Let's answer the hail.
USS Ajax. Sensors show your ship is completely defenseless. And I would prefer not to delay our arrival at Earth to deal with such a minor annoyance. Surrender now, and I will guarantee the safety of your crew.
We will never surrender. Let's access the ship's computer. Warning, hull breaches on decks 4, 5, and 6. Emergency force fields are engaged. Hull integrity is at 22%. Weapons and shields are offline. Life support is on emergency backups. Let's check the casualty report. Betazoid, Telar Prime, Vulcan, all taken or uninhabitable. Casualties in the billions. Gee whiz, we're at war with the Dominion by the look of it. Captain's personal log? We haven't seen the bulk of the enemy fleet in 3 days, but their scouts continue to harass us. Vulcan is lost. Andoria is in flames. Romulus, Telar Prime, Beta Z, Trill, all ashes. If the Romulans had joined us, maybe this would have been different. The Klingons barely had enough ships left to patrol their home system. They weren't a threat anymore. We were offering friendship, but the Romulans refused us, and then the Dominion came and took everything. Scan for Iconian activity. No known Iconian activity in the immediate area. Let's download data and end the program. Well, that simulation did not work out anything like what we were told to expect. Let's speak with this guy again.
Sorry, we were watching from the control room, and that could have gone better. Even with all that, the simulation data on whether the Iconians were entirely eliminated from that timeline is inconclusive. We were able to record your interactions, and we've been able to piece together what happened from those.
What did you find?
From what we can piece together, the Klingon Empire was never unified by its conflicts against outsiders, and the great houses turned on one another instead. The Romulans took the chaos as an opportunity to attack. The Federation stepped in to help the Klingons, and the war between the three factions basically ripped the Quadrant apart. The Dominion then conquered all three weakened powers.
That's not our solution.
Agreed. My team will continue working on other possible incursion scenarios.
Perhaps we can weaken their power base. Noya, whiny boy again.
Another one of you voyagers. I don't know how you can help, but very well. My team is working on scenarios that reduce the Iconian power base. We're attempting to do so by fixing a mistake that Janeway allowed to happen decades ago. We're going to stop the Vardwar from being rediscovered. We plan to do this by preventing Voyager from ever coming into contact with Underspace. This will prevent them from finding Vardwar Prime, and Seven of Nine will never wake the Vardwar.
Don't know what you mean by Voyagers. I never served on that ship.
No, but you're all the same. You come to our quadrant, meddle in affairs that don't concern you and that you don't understand, and leave chaos in your wake. Now you want us to help you alter time. Tell me, does that sound like something someone like you should be doing?
I'm not entirely sure that kind of power should be in your hands either.
None of us are going to survive if we don't try to repair the damage you've already done. The goal is to cause a solar flare that will force Voyager to divert from the course it was on when it stumbled into underspace. If it safely passes without entering underspace, it can continue on its trip home and bypass the Vardwar entirely.
Sounds like that could work.
The simulation is set for the USS Voyager, which is fitting since they caused the problem in the first place. Our projections show that even if the Vardwar never return, your people will still find a reason to stick your noses into our business. So we're attempting to see how the elimination of the Vardwar will change the formation of the Delta Alliance. You will be a member of the diplomatic team.
I will run the program.
Don't mind Noi. I think he partially blames people from your quadrant for some of the Krennan's troubles. After all, if Voyager hadn't restored the Vardwar, they would have never been in a position to ally with the Iconians. But there is no reason to dwell on past hurts. We're trying to fix what we can here, and then learn to accept the rest. Noi funnels that passion to help his people into his work. Perhaps it will change everything.
Thank you for your honesty.
It is a pleasure to meet you. Both Captain Nog and Seven speak highly of you.
Goodbye. Okay, let's do the next holodeck simulation on USS Voyager. Okay, so there's a big argument by the looks of it. Benthan, Hazari, Malon, and a Talaxian. Anyone else? Nope. Let's talk to Ambassador Sugihara.
This is an absolute disaster. I had thought that Admiral Tuvok was being pessimistic about the chance for success here. But now, I think he was right.
The Alliance isn't making a quick process?
No, it's not. The hierarchy started setting these people against one another before Admiral Tuvok and his team could start to pull them together. The very fact that they all agreed to be in the same room is a minor miracle.
Do you think you can bring them together?
Eventually.
Between Vulcan logic, Klingon tenacity, and Romulan pragmatism, we'll convince everyone here that the threat is real and an alliance is in their best interest. But it won't be easy. Now, if you'll excuse me, I see I have another argument to break up.
Good luck, Ambassador.
We've always tried to be good neighbors and treat other races with respect, but this is really too much. The Melon are using our system as a dump, and their trash isn't our problem.
You have a right to be concerned, but please calm down.
I should be shouting. I'm upset. The Melon are trying to force us off our beautiful new planet so they can turn it into something toxic. How would you like it if someone treated your ship like a garbage scow?
Maybe you're right. I'd be angry too.
We've always tried to be good neighbors and treat other races with respect, but this is really too much. The Melon are using our system as a dump, and their trash isn't our problem.
The Melon aren't the biggest danger to your people.
The Melon might not be the biggest threat, but they are the most immediate. Wait until they start dumping their trash in your front yard and see how you like it.
Keep talking to the Melon. Perhaps you can find a compromise. Yeah.
Are you here to preach about responsible waste management too? You can save it. I have a commitment to my people and my planet that supersedes any other concerns.
Isn't there somewhere else you can dump your waste without harming others?
We don't need outsiders telling us what to do. If the Talaxians want to talk, they can come to us directly.
Let me see if there's another way to get you interested in joining this conversation. We have access to the computer console now. The Melon have resisted attempts to accept less hazardous waste management practices and continue dumping waste throughout the quadrant. The most at-risk population are the Talaxians, who have a new colony close to the Melon dumping grounds. The Melon have moved into Talaxian space to avoid hierarchy attacks. Diplomatic relations between the Melon and the Talaxians are rapidly deteriorating. The Melon have accused the Talaxians of working with the hierarchy, a charge the Talaxians strenuously deny. The Benthans could pressure the Melon to return to the negotiating table. Let's check in with the Benthans.
Yes, what is your question? I am rather busy. The Hazari are stepping up their smuggling operations, and the Hierarchy's new drive for profits has created a significant increase in attacks on unaligned transports.
Sorry to trouble you. I'll talk to the Hazari.
Good luck with that. The Hazari aren't interested in anything but making deals. This whole meeting is just a waste of time. Unity might work where you come from, but I don't have any reason to cooperate with criminals like the Hazari or thugs like the Hierarchy.
I'll try to convince them differently.
What do you want? Did the Benthans make you one of their little deputies? Or was it the Melon? Before everyone broke ties with the Hierarchy, they told us what people say about us. Mercenaries. Honorless. Ha! They all deny it. But we know. Now we look out for ourselves.
Well, if that's how you think, I guess we're done.
Fine. Run back to the Benthans. I'll be here if you want to talk business.
Sorry, but I'm not in the market for mercenaries.
Unraveling this mess could take months, years.
You're the right man for the job, Ambassador. Oh, look, everybody's running away. Leaving Ambassador on his own. Okay. Let's see what's going on. Quadrant Threat Report. Number of planets the Hierarchy have taken outright has increased 20% over the past 6 months. A push for higher profits has prompted steady growth of Hierarchy territory. Reports of abductions in areas near Hierarchy space have increased by 77%. The data has not been confirmed by outside sources because few Delta Quadrant species are willing to share information with the Federation. Further investigation is needed. Ship's log. Our allies in the Kiana system have been invaded by hierarchy forces. The Kiana colony is a small farming community with no strategic value, so the attack simply doesn't make sense. According to the one survivor we managed to find, the hierarchy were working with the Alachi. The Alachi took captives to an unknown location. Scan for Iconian activity. Long-range sensors are detecting both Herald and Iconian readings. While they do not appear to be in active conflict with Alliance forces, you're seeing more ships than normal. There are both Herald and Iconian signals in Hierarchy space. It appears the Heralds may be using that area as a staging ground for a coordinated attack with the Hierarchy on high-value targets throughout the Delta Quadrant. Cross-checking with Voyager's logs shows a similar situation in Alpha and Beta quadrants. Okay, so not much change here then. Let's end the program. What is that? No idea what that is, but I really want to know. Okay, let's go find Noi again.
Damn, that was useless. The Iconians were so determined to have a hold here that they simply found another species to fit the bill. Maybe if you had been a better negotiator, you would have been able to unite those representatives against the hierarchy. Then at least we would have had a chance.
Maybe we wouldn't.
This scenario isn't as catastrophic as trying to remove the Iconians, but it's not exactly ideal either. We'll have to try something else.
Yeah, this isn't going to work.
You must excuse my husband's harsh demeanor. This has been a very trying time for the Krenim. Thank you for helping us get this far. We'll keep working.
Thank you.
Trust my wife to be the voice of reason. Perhaps I was too hard on you. I just want to be able to fix all of this. We can't turn back time, but we can change it. Please speak to Gamma Team. Captain Nog thinks very highly of their plan.
Thank you. I'll speak to the Gamma Team. Where's the Gamma Team? There they are.
Hello. We've been waiting for you. Our team is focusing on delaying tactics. What if Iconia had never been discovered? In 2365, Captain Donald Varley of the USS Yamato found a star chart on Danaeus 3 that revealed the location of Iconia. I want to redirect a meteor to impact the archaeological site on Danaeus 3 before Captain Varley begins his excavations. Iconia will remain a myth, and we will not attract the Iconians' attention as early as we did.
That's just a delay. Another gateway was found a few years later.
True, but if you compare the changes in Iconian technology over the past 200,000 years with what the rest of us have done in the past two centuries, it's obvious that the Iconian culture has stagnated while we have advanced rapidly. Additionally, there are other factors in play that could trigger the alliances and sharing of technology that have come about because of the Iconian threat. It's a risk, but it's one that could pay off.
I see why you're trying this on a holodeck first.
The program is set for Romulan space. Because the Hobus supernova was caused by direct Iconian interference, we expect Romulus to be intact in this new reality. As such, the Romulan Star Empire should once again be a major power in the quadrant. Your role will be as an officer on a Romulan warbird.
Okie dokie. I forgot she sounded incredibly chipper. Oh dear. Let's go run the holodeck. Commander Tamer is waiting for you, sir. Oh, that's pretty cool. Anyone who's played through the Romulan mission storyline will know who Commander Tamer is and what he does. I've started a Romulan character and I've recorded the tutorial, but I haven't actually played anything yet or edited the video to upload it. Could be a while before that ever actually happens, because we're focusing on Kolos right now. Let's speak with Commander Tamer.
Ah, Subcommander. I'd like to test out some new security passcodes. If you'd be so kind as to seal the doors and disable certain equipment, we need to talk.
Understood, Commander. Seal the door. And disable Tal Shiar listening devices. Let's go back to Commander Tamer and have a chat with him.
Thank you for playing along, Subcommander. The Tal Shiar can't hear us now. I need to talk to you about Datan and the Separatists. They've been located near the Dewa system. What we do next could change our future.
You're not asking if we should attack them, are you?
If I was, I wouldn't have needed you to lock the door. I intend to put Lieutenant Salon in the brig, and then take this ship and crew to join the Separatists. Are you with me?
If we do this, we're going to be traitors to the Empire.
I know. I have tried to work within the system, but the system is broken and corrupt. Datan and his people are building something better. You and I both know it. The crew knows it. We will take this warbird to Datan, and we will finally be free.
We have to do what is best for our people. Okay, let's go put Lieutenant Salan in the brig. Unseal the door. Where is he? There he is.
Secret conversations between the commander and one of his senior officers? Very suspicious. Loyal citizens of the Romulan Star Empire have no need for locked doors.
He's not been assimilated. He's just Romulan. I'm going to have to ask you to accompany the security team to the brig.
Tamer, you are a fool, and you will be the death of everyone on this ship. Datan and his people are terrorists. If you join them, you will share their fate.
You are under arrest. Please comply and you will not be harmed.
My friends, it is time we forge our own destiny. A destiny free from the tyranny of the Tal Shiar. If we leave, we will have a better, brighter future than what they would allow us. I know this is a step into the unknown, but it is a step we will take together. Throw off your chains. We will join our brothers and sisters in freedom.
Okay.
I wanted to let you know that I am with you and Commander Tamer. Some of my family has left Romulus to join Datan. I'll be proud to join them.
Set course for the Dewa 3 system. Well, Dewa system. Dewa 3 is the planet we're accessing. Let's access the computer. Traitors in our midst. The historical executions of traitors to the Star Empire has been moved to 2100 hours. Attendance is mandatory for officers not on duty at that time. Yeah, right. Like, people are actually going to go to that. Quadrant status report. Starfleet vessels have been assisting new Romulans in areas near the neutral zone. Imperial ships are being dispatched in a show of force. Any ships harbouring or assisting the Separatists are to be fired upon. There are no exceptions. Ships in Group Gamma are being reassigned to patrol in the area targeted by the Borg. Contacts are regular, but vigilance is needed to eradicate the threat and protect our colony worlds. Okay, so there's a Borg presence in this timeline. Personal log. Gaius is becoming quite suspicious. I've been talking to members of the senior staff, and most are in favour of making a run for the flotilla and joining Datan. But I remain cautious. They are doing the right thing, but the Borg are nipping at our heels. Every ship the fleet loses might be one needed to protect Romulus in its hour of need. But what is left there to protect? Let's scan for Iconian activity. No Herald or Iconian signatures. No references to Heralds in the ship's database. The only references to Iconians are in the historical files, and most refer to the Iconians as a myth. There are heightened levels of Borg activity throughout the Beta Quadrant, and multiple colony worlds have been assimilated. The Romulan fleets are on high alert, but have not been able to make major inroads against the Collective. Let's download the data and end the program. Let's go back and speak with whoever it is we're speaking with. Oh yeah, Jillian.
That is the most promising simulation yet. It appears there was some merit to our hypothesis that the Iconians advanced their plans due to early contact.
It's not perfect by any means.
The readings do indicate higher levels of Borg activity, but it should be an acceptable risk.
Do you think this could be our solution?
The data in this simulation does show higher Borg activity than we're currently seeing, but there are no signs of Herald, Iconian, or Solanae presence at all. And while the Romulan Star Empire is restored to their former power, there is a democratic Romulan group opposing the Tal Shiar. And more importantly, Romulus is intact. This is the result many of our Romulan researchers have been trying to bring about.
This isn't our reality. We'll be significantly altering everything we know.
The political calculus of the Quadrant will change, but the data supports what you saw on the holodeck. No Iconians. We have solid projections. The only suggestion I have now is that you consider it in conjunction with Captain Nog and the Republic representatives here.
I will discuss it with them.
This last test has the most promising results I've seen, and saving the Romulan homeworld is an added bonus. We're not going to have a lot of shots at this. I've been looking at Anorex's work, and I think it's too easy to get into a temporal loop where you try again and again for a specific result, and time starts fighting back. I'm inclined to say this is our best chance. But this will have a huge impact on the reality we know, especially your people, Commander Jirok. I won't give my authorization without hearing from everyone.
We can't move forward without considering the effect on the Republic, Commander Jirok.
This is difficult. It would change everything for us. We'd have our home back, but the Republic, everything we've built, it would all be gone. But there's still hope. Even in this other reality, Datan has led many Romulans away from Sela and her Tal Shiar thugs.
This does impact the Republic quite a bit.
The simulation specifically mentioned Datan and a separatist movement. Commander Temer makes the choice to join Datan, the same choice he made after the homeworld was lost. With Romulus, we could have numbers. More people who have had enough of the Tal Shiar's oppression could join us. Maybe millions more. If Datan is able to get a movement going, even at the height of the Empire's power, I have to believe that change is possible.
What do you think we should do?
Make the incursion. The lives we save will be worth the work we'll have to do to reform the Republic. The Tal Shiar wasn't able to stop us the first time. They won't stop us again.
If the Romulan Republic thinks it's worth the risk, we should try it. Sir, we've been informed that the Lisette and the Krenim vessel will be travelling with us to the site of the temporal incursion. The Krenim vessel has the weapon on board, and the Lisette will provide additional security and manpower if needed. Anything else? All three vessels will be temporarily shielded to protect us from changes in the timeline. As long as that shielding holds, we'll be able to observe the changes and even interact with them, but we will not be part of the new timeline. Captain Nog says the temporal shield generators can be damaged. We'll need to be careful. We can beam you up to the Znordoth as soon as you're ready. Prepare for immediate departure.
To see the world of my birth again. Elements? Is that Romulus? It's been completely assimilated.
Uh-oh.
Yes, I think we have a problem.
No. We expected to see some Borg activity, but this can't be right.
So, what happened?
I agree that this is unexpected, Commander, but we knew there would be anomalies. We need more information. Let's find out where the simulation might have gone wrong.
Stay on the edge of the system. Jurok and I will move in for sensor sweeps. The last thing we need is the Borg assimilating the Krenim weapon.
The whole system can't be assimilated. Can it? That is a lot of Borg.
Yep, indeed. And we have to go in closer. Okay, so. Scan Romulus for data centers. I have a funny feeling I'm going to be fighting the Borg in a minute. Scan Romulus for data centers.
According to these scans, the planet has been completely assimilated. I'm not detecting any non-Borg life signs. This is bad. Really, really bad. We need to fix this.
Agreed.
Borg ships decloaking. Red alert.
Great. The Borg have cloaking devices now. Shields up.
First the Klingons, now the Borg. Does everyone steal cloaking technology from us?
Oh man, a cube. Whoops. Got myself all blown up. Okay, let's go take out that last Borg ship. I thought it was just the cube, I had to worry about. Okay, we're not going to be affected by the timeline shift if we leave the ship then.
I've modified some personal shield generators to shield you temporally as well. I'm transporting them over now. Hurry, the temporal shielding drains a lot of power. won't have much time down there before you're unprotected. If that happens, this will be your new reality.
Uh-oh. Yeah, don't want that. Claudia says she is concerned about the weapon. We probably only have one more shot before the capacitor's burnt out, so we need to get this right now. So we need to get this right now and get back to a timeline that's not overrun by the Borg. Sensors are detecting a mainframe that should have the data you need. The Lisette will remain to protect the Krenim ship while you and Commander Jarok beam down to gather information. Okie dokie. Let's beam down. Yep, I'll stick to that.
We need more data to plot a possible solution. With any luck, the Borg will have what we need. Maybe. Our focus is on restoration. There is a computer node in this area of the Unimatrix that should have what we need. Find the node and download all the data you can from the point where we made our incursion. That should help us find out how to fix this.
Okay, let's find the data.
I'm going to join you. I know this place, or at least I knew this place. Before we lost the homeworld, it was a Tal Shiar complex. Most of the secrets of our empire were stored here. I thought I was getting my home back, but now the Borg have taken it all away. This is like losing Romulus all over again.
Let's see what we can do, Commander.
The controls ahead of us will unlock the bulkheads.
I just had a thought. Have I upgraded my weapons that upgraded yet? No, I haven't upgraded that one. Okay. Let's equip that again. Anybody got an upgrade? Oh, Kagan has one that upgrades. I don't think anybody else has one at the moment. Where did it go? There it is. nope, that doesn't upgrade. Neither does that or that. None of the rest of them by the look of it. Okay. Let's go.
The whole planet.
Whoa.
Our people. They're bored.
They're waking up. Of course, I'm too low level for the Borg to adapt to my weapons at the moment. I think they start adapting at level 40. So anyone who's above level 40 and able to play this needs a frequency remodulator, which you can get from your inventory's replicator at zero charge. You need to equip that in your captain, one of these slots, and every time the Borg adapt to your weapons, you can rotate the frequencies using that device. It's a bit annoying.
I can't believe we were so wrong.
Of course, the easiest way around that is to buy one of the weapons, or obtain one of the weapons that automatically adapts and changes its own frequency.
Door controls.
Let's just grab these items of loot. So let's see what all we get at the end. Okay, more Borg waking up. And even more Borg waking up.
Got it.
Okay, let's go through, see where we end up. More Borg.
We have to find a way to make this right.
Can we get through without waking them up? Nope. Okay, let's continue.
Resistance is futile.
There, that's the access node console we need.
Okay.
Locked. We'll have to circumvent their security measures. Wait! Incoming Borg!
This is not good. Okay, let's see if we can get to these consoles. Circumvent the security here. Uh oh, Borg beaming in.
When we lost the homeworld, I thought that was the worst thing that could happen to us.
Okay. More of them. Circumvent the security here as well.
You will be assimilated.
And more Borg.
This was Romulan technology once, but it's been completely assimilated. Akiv?
You will become one with the Borg. Resistance
oh, no.
is futile.
Of course, we've never met Akiv yet, but... He is a very formidable foe indeed. Now that he's assimilated, he could be much more awkward to kill. I don't know, he seems to go down pretty quick though. There he goes. Let's see. Oh, he's dropped something green. What did he drop? Oh, disruptor pulse wave assault. That could be nice. I'll have to see if I can equip that on someone afterwards. Okay, let's go back to here and download data. Let's open temporal records. Okay. Drones accessing breakdown records by year. Provide a summary of events for Romulus system only. Display results with oldest entries first. Stardate, blah blah. Romulus system added to the collective. That's about 10 years ago, I think. Maybe 15, 20. Unimatrix established in orbit of Romulus. Designated Unimatrix 652. All adjuncts of Unimatrix 652. Designated into Trimatrix 1152 through 1274. Let's download this data.
It looks like the main invasion of Romulan space occurred about 20 years ago. Something happened in the Delta Quadrant. The Borg assimilated something that greatly improved their technology. They adapted, evolved, and my people, they didn't have a chance. Maybe it's our fate to lose Romulus.
All we can do now is try to restore the previous timeline. Maybe this will help. Borg signatures on approach. Let's get out of there, sir. Beam us up.
Let's get out of here. There are more than 20 Borg ships on an intercept course.
20 Borg ships? Oh, God.
More Borg on the way.
Okay.
Borg decloaking.
What? No. Oof.
Transmit the data! Hurry! We're under attack!
Nog?
We're losing power! Send the data now before we lose temporal shielding!
Sending the data now.
Focus on your repairs. We will make sure the data is preserved.
Okay. Press data logs.
Data is compressed and ready.
Modulate subspace communications array.
Communications array is ready.
Secure transfer.
Secure channel confirmed.
Send data to the timeship.
Data received.
I'm running the numbers now. If we target the Borg transwarp network, the Borg may never be able to reach Romulus.
It is a great risk. The Borg have a great deal of influence on the timeline. There is no time to run simulations.
Do we have a choice?
We do not. Targeting the transwarp network.
Firing the weapon! Now!
The Borg are gone. But so is Romulus.
Romulus isn't the only thing we lost. Temporal shielding is failing.
What happened?
The Borg did too much damage to the generators. If we lose the temporal shielding, we'll all reintegrate with the timeline.
Has anything else changed?
Checking. No. The Deuterians. They're gone.
What? How?
I see the problem. 20 years ago, your people tried to replicate the work of the Solanae to protect themselves from the Borg. In this timeline, they failed.
Temporal shield is at 8%.
No, I need to restabilize the shields.
I'm downloading my personal files into the shielded core. You'll have all my research notes and everything we've recorded from this mission.
You're giving up? When the shield fails, Deuterians were lost in the past, then you'll be lost too.
Temporal shield is losing integrity.
Is there anything we can do?
No, we all knew the risks. I love.
There has been a development, Captain. Captain Nog, Commander Jarok, and the Krenim researchers are waiting for you in the conference room to go over their findings. Very well, I'll meet them there. Captain Nog.
We found a temporally shielded computer core, and it shows two uses of the Krenim weapon. But as far as I know, the Iconians are still out there. We changed the timeline, but we didn't fix our most important problem.
What was in the core?
We haven't dug that far into the data yet, and it will take some in-depth investigation to catalog all of the changes. Noi is going to lead the group taking care of that. I will say it is... odd to find personal logs I don't remember making.
I imagine that would be strange.
Very. But from what we've already seen, it appears the reason the weapon was fired twice was because we had to try to correct a change we made. Technology like this seems so simple, but even the smallest change can make more trouble than it solves. We have to be more cautious. Far more cautious than we've already been, I suppose. The next mistake might not be fixable. Time alteration might not be the answer. There are some problems that can't be solved with a weapon. But time travel... Look, whatever happens, it was good working with you. I hope we have the chance to do so in the future.
It was good working with you too, Captain. Speak with Noia.
I have a lot of information to analyze. The shielded core appears to have made it through the process intact, and will give us a wealth of data on the timeline and how the changes have affected it. Clearly, you made a mistake somewhere. I still feel this is the best technology available to us. But we will need minds sufficient to the task to operate it.
Huh. Goodbye. Whiny boy. Let's see what Adran has got to say.
I was conducting another simulation, and all of a sudden I got an emergency call telling me to stop everything. I will be looking at whatever data we managed to save to try and determine what went wrong. Maybe we can try again after we know more.
I hope you find something. We can't afford another incident like what we've just heard about.
It has been good to have you here, but we will have to consider if time alteration is really the best course of action. Of all the records we have of time travel, few have as drastic a result as this. Perhaps removing elements from the time stream isn't the solution we need.
Maybe not.
We've put so much hope into using the Krenim technology to solve our problems. Perhaps I was caught up in the possibilities and blind to the potential for disaster. We tried and we failed. But this isn't the end. We'll keep looking at the simulations as well as any other option open to us. I have to have faith that we will find a way to defeat the Iconians.
We'll discover what happened and move on from there. It's all we can do. Sir, I'm concerned about using time travel to solve the Iconian situation as well, but this is one of the only options we have left that they don't. I hope whatever the Alliance decides to do, we don't end up in a worse situation than we're already in. Are you ready to transport back to the Zanordoth? Yes. Okay, so all I have left to do is hail Captain Kagran and hand in the mission, but before I do so, my little one complaint about this mission is the Tutarians. We are introduced to Noy's wife, Clauda, and she should have really had a presence in the previous missions if we were really going to feel sorry for her and the fact that her species was basically vanished by the time line changes. Just disappointed that it wasn't done, because it's just a character introduced so that she can die, in other words. Let's hail Captain Kagran.
Captain Nog tells me that the initial test of the Krenim weapon was less than promising. He says that he and his team have a great deal of data still to analyze, but I do not believe they will find much that will assist us. Removing elements from the time stream is reckless. And while our options are limited, we should not destroy ourselves in a fruitless effort to destroy the Iconians. It is time to consider all of our alternatives.
Indeed. Okay. Let's take that console.
Congratulations, Captain.
Thank you, Worf. Okay, let's put it in place of this shield. Thingy here, Mark II. It's very old. Okay, and sometime in the next wee while I'm going to try and replay the Dust to Dust mission, get myself Mark VI versions of the Kobali set. Maybe even a Mark VIII warp core from somewhere. I might actually replay this mission to get the Mark VIII warp core. I don't know why, but... What's this one doing? It says boost and shield power. I'll stick with that one, actually, for now. Anyway, thanks for sticking with me through this mission. It's been maybe a bit less in the way of comments from me, and I may have sounded a bit less animated than maybe usual. Anyway, bye for now. See you guys next time.